Friends, if you want to watch super hit movie The Mummy Returns in English, then you must like this video. If you are visiting our channel for the first time, don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Friends, in today's video, the movie we are going to talk about is called The Mummy Returns. We will talk about what this movie is and where you can watch it, all the interesting facts about this movie. In today's video, I am going to tell you. I am also going to give you all the information on which OTT platform or on which satellite channel you will get to watch this movie. Also, we will talk in detail about the technical department, music department, pre-production, filming, post-production, budget, box office collection of this film. We will also talk about the story of this film, and I will also give you a small review of the story of this film. Apart from this, we will discuss about the facts of this film, storyline, star cast, actors' performance in the film, and which character has played which role. That's why I request you friends to watch this video till the end, so let's start the video. The Mummy Returns is a 2001 American action fantasy film written and directed by Steven Sommers, starring Brendan Fraser, Rachel Weisz, John Hannah, Arnold Vosloo, Oded Fehr, Patricia Velasquez, Freddie Both, Alun Armstrong, and Dwayne Johnson in his film acting debut. The film is a sequel to the 1999 film The Mummy and was distributed by Universal Pictures. The Mummy Returns inspired the 2002 prequel film The Scorpion King, a spin-off that is set 5,000 years prior and whose eponymous character, played by Dwayne Johnson The Rock, was introduced in this film. Like its predecessor, The Mummy Returns was a commercial success despite receiving mixed reviews. Movie plot. In 3067 BC, a fearsome warrior known as the Scorpion King leads an army to conquer the world. However, they are eventually defeated and exiled to the desert of Almshir. Dying, the Scorpion King vows to give Anubis his soul in return for the power to defeat his enemies. Anubis accepts, magically conjuring an oasis and golden pyramid, and giving the Scorpion King an army of jackal-like warriors to conquer Egypt. However, once his task is finished, Anubis claims the Scorpion King's soul, and the army is returned to the underworld. In 1933 AD, Rick O'Connell and his wife, Evelyn, explore ancient ruins with their son, Alex, finding the bracelet of Anubis. In London, the bracelet locks onto Alex, showing him visions directing him to Almshir. Evelyn is attacked and captured by a cult who resurrect Imhotep with the Book of the Dead. They wish to use his power to defeat the Scorpion King, which would give them command of Anubis' army. The cult, led by museum curator Baltus Hafez, includes enforcer Lok Na and Mila Nyes, the physical reincarnation of Imhotep's love Ankh Su-Naemun. Rick and Alex set out to rescue Evelyn with the help of her brother Jonathan, who had gotten his hands on a mysterious golden scepter, and the Magi Ardith Bey, who has returned to help them. Rick frees Evelyn after a massive battle, but Alex is soon kidnapped and forced to lead the cult with his visions from the bracelet. The O'Connells pursue them with Rick's associate Izzy. Along the way, Alex leaves clues for his parents, who follow in Izzy's dirigible. Imhotep uses the Book of the Dead to restore Ankh Su-Naemun's soul into Mila's body, but by doing so, he unwittingly allows Evelyn to unlock the memories of her previous life as Princess Nefertiti, the bracelet's keeper and Pharaoh Seti I's daughter. At the edge of the oasis, Imhotep realizes they are being pursued and uses his magic to crash the dirigible. Izzy stays behind to repair it. The O'Connells infiltrate the cult, but both groups are attacked by pygmy mummies. Rick retrieves Alex while Ardif kills Lok Na. They escape the pygmies, who kill all the cult members except for Hafez, Imhotep, and Ankh Su-Naemun. The O'Connells arrive at the pyramid, and the bracelet detaches from Alex. Ankh Su-Naemun, Imhotep, and Hafez then arrive and kill Evelyn before entering the pyramid. Inside the pyramid, Imhotep's powers are taken from him, forcing him to face the Scorpion King as a mortal. Hafez uses the bracelet to conjure Anubis' army, which appears outside of the oasis. Rick finds Imhotep summoning the Scorpion King and attacks him. The Scorpion King, now an enormous scorpion monster, interrupts the fight. Imhotep tricks him into attacking Rick while outside, Ardith and the Magi battle Anubis's resurrected army. While Rick and the Scorpion King fight, Hafez is caught in the melee and killed. Meanwhile, Jonathan and Alex steal the Book of the Dead from Ankh-Su-Namun and use it to resurrect Evelyn. Rick discovers hieroglyphs explaining that Jonathan's scepter is the mystical spear of Osiris. With the help of Jonathan and the resurrected Evelyn, Rick gets the scepter and uses it to slay the Scorpion King, sending him and the army back into the underworld. As the oasis begins to implode and the pyramid crumbles, Rick and Imhotep cling to the ledge of a pit that leads to the underworld. Rick implores Evelyn to escape before it is too late, but she risks her life to pull Rick to safety. Seeing this, Imhotep pleads for Ankh-Su-Namun to do the same, but she abandons him. Heartbroken, Imhotep lets go and falls into the underworld. While fleeing, Ankh-Su-Namun inadvertently falls into a pit of scorpions, killing her. At the last moment, Izzy arrives with a modified dirigible and rescues the O'Connells just before the oasis and the pyramid are destroyed, though not before Jonathan swipes the pyramid's diamond capstone. They depart into the sunset, with Ardith Bay saluting them before riding off. Cast: Brendan Fraser as Rick O'Connell, a treasure hunter and former legionnaire. Rachel Weisz as Evelyn O'Connell Nefertiri, respectively, Rick's wife, and the daughter of Pharaoh Seti I. John Hannah as Jonathan Carnahan, Evelyn's brother. Arnold Vosloo as Imhotep, High Priest of Osiris and lover of Ankh-Su-Namun. Oded Fehr as Ardith Bay, a Magi chieftain and warrior. Patricia Velasquez as Mila Nye's Ankh-Su-Namun, the mistress of Pharaoh Seti I and secret lover of Imhotep. Freddie Both as Alex O'Connell, Rick and Evelyn's son. Dwayne Johnson as Matthias of Akkad, the Scorpion King, an ancient warrior who sold his soul to Anubis. Alun Armstrong as Baltus Hafez, the cult leader. Adwaya Lakinoy Agbage as Loch Nau, a cult enforcer. Sean Parks as Izzy Buttons, Rick's friend and a dirigible pilot. Bruce Byron as Red Willits, a thief contracted by the cult to claim the bracelet of Anubis. Joe Dixon as Jacques, a thief contracted by the cult to claim the bracelet of Anubis. Tom Fisher as Spivey, a thief contracted by the cult to claim the bracelet of Anubis. Aharon Ipalay as Pharaoh Seti I, the Pharaoh of Egypt, whom Imhotep killed in 1290 BC. Music: The Mummy Returns, original motion picture soundtrack, was released on May 1, 2001 by Decca Records. It contains the score composed and conducted by Alan Silvestri, as well as a version of the song Forever May Not Be Long Enough by the rock band Live, which slightly differs from the song's album version. A 2-CD expansion was released by Intrada Records in 2018. Box office: The Mummy Returns earned $23.4 million on its first day of release, then made $26.8 million the day after. This made it the highest Friday and Saturday grosses, surpassing both Toy Story 2 and The Lost World, Jurassic Park respectively. Later that year, those records were simultaneously given to Planet of the Apes and Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. During its opening weekend, the film made $68.1 million, making it the second highest opening weekend of all time, only behind The Lost World, Jurassic Park. Moreover, it surpassed Hannibal to have the highest opening weekend for a 2001 film, joining Monsters, Inc., Rush Hour 2 and Planet of the Apes to become one of the only four films of that year to make $60 million in their first 3 days of release. The film also became one of four consecutive Universal films of the year to cross the $40 million in an opening weekend, with the others being American Pie 2, The Fast and the Furious and Jurassic Park Roman 3. The Mummy Returns would remain in the number one spot at the box office for 2 weeks until Shrek took it. The film grossed $202 million in the United States and Canada box offices and $233 million internationally, grossing over $435 million worldwide, making it the seventh highest grossing film of 2001. Critical response: The Mummy Returns received mixed reviews from critics, It currently holds a 46% rating on Rotten Tomatoes based on 141 reviews, with an average rating of 5.3. The site's consensus states, in The Mummy Returns, the special effects are impressive, but the characters seem secondary to the computer-generated imagery. Metacritic reported an average rating of 48 out of 100 based on 31 reviews, indicating mixed or average reviews. Audiences polled by CinemaScore gave the film an average grade of A on an A+ to F scale. Roger Ebert, who awarded the first film 3 stars, gave the second film only 2, saying that the mistake of The Mummy Returns is to abandon the characters and to use the plot only as a clothesline for special effects and action sequences. James Berardinelli of RealViews gave the film 2.5 stars out of 4, calling it hollow, lightweight entertainment not unpleasant, but far from the Sommers' definitive action-adventure flick. Kenneth Turan of the Los Angeles Times gave the film a positive review, praising its constant plot turns, cheeky sensibility, and omnipresent action sequences. Todd McCarthy of Variety praised the non-stop action of the final hour, saying that it bursts with visual goodies. Joe Morgenstern of the Wall Street Journal gave the film a negative review, saying that it has all of the clank but none of the swank of the previous version. Charles Taylor of Salon.com was also not impressed, calling The Mummy Returns everything the first Mummy was fun for not being. Home Media. The Mummy Returns debuted on VHS and DVD on October 2, 2001. It would become the fastest-selling DVD ever in the United States, with 2 million copies being sold after its first week. This record would be taken by Star Wars, Episode I: The Phantom Menace, just 2 weeks later. The film was subsequently released on the high-definition Blu-ray format in July 2008, and on OOD Blu-ray in 2017. Video games. 2 video games based on the movie were released. The first was released on the Game Boy Color, developed by GameBrains, and was released within the film's theatrical release. The other is for the PlayStation 2, developed by Blitz Games, and was released in October 2001, to coincide with the film's home media release. Both titles were published by Universal Interactive. The Mummy Returns movie review. It is a curiosity of movie action that too much of it can be boring. Imagine yourself on a roller coaster for 2 hours. After the first 10 minutes, the thrills subside. The mistake of The Mummy Returns is to abandon the characters and to use the plot only as a clothesline for special effects and action sequences. If it were not for references to The Mummy 1999, this sequel would hardly have a plot at all. 9 years have passed. Brendan Fraser is back again as Egyptologist Rick O'Connell, and Rachel Weisz, the librarian he met in the first film, is now his wife. They have an 8-year-old son named Alex Freddy Both. Also back are John Hannah as the Twitty brother-in-law Jonathan and Arnold Vosloo as the mummy Imhotep, whose name sounds more than ever like an ancient Egyptian chain of pancake houses. Odid Fayer is the worried sage Ardith Bey, who begins sentences ominously with, "It is written that." Until Rick finally snaps, "Where is all this written?" A good question, since much of the story involves a magical pyramid of which it is written, no one who has seen it has ever returned alive. That logically leads us to wonder how they ever found out about it. But logic applied to this movie will drive you mad. So will any attempt to summarize the plot. So I will be content with various observations. The ads give The Rock, the World Wrestling Federation star, equal billing with Fraser. This is bait and switch. To call his appearance a cameo would be stretching it. He appears briefly at the beginning of the movie, is transmuted into a kind of transparent skeletal wraith, and disappears until the end of the film, when he comes back as the dreaded Scorpion King. I am not sure, at the end, if we see the real Rock or merely his face, connected to computer-generated effects. His scorpion is blown up to giant size, which has the unfortunate effect of making him look more like a lobster tail than a scorpion. I continue to believe The Rock has an acting career ahead of him, and after seeing this movie, I believe it is still ahead of him. Alex, the kid, adds a lot to the movie by acting just like a kid. I particularly enjoyed it when he was kidnapped by a fearsome adversary of his parents, chained and taken on a long journey, during which he drove his captor crazy by incessantly asking, "Are we there yet?" The dialogue, "You have started a chain reaction that could bring about the next apocalypse," is fascinating. Apparently, we missed the first apocalypse, which does not speak well for it. I have written before of the ability of movie characters to outrun fireballs. In The Mummy Returns, there is a more amazing feat. If the rising sun touches little Alex while he is wearing the magical bracelet, he will die, it is written. But Rick, carrying Alex in his arms, is able to outrace the sunrise. We see the line of sunlight moving on the ground right behind them. It is written by Eratosthenes that the Earth is about 25,000 miles around. And since there are 24 hours in a day, Rick was running approximately 141 miles an hour. One of the big action sequences involves a battle between two vast armies, which stretch as far as computer-generated effects can see. One army is human. The other army is made of countless creatures named Anubis that look like giant savage dogs that stand upright and run on their hind legs. It is not done well, but one is surprised to find it done at all. These armies clash in bloody swordplay. Each dog creature, as it is killed, reverts to the desert sand from whence it sprang. Finally, all the creatures are destroyed, and we see the victors standing around feeling victorious and wishing that high fives had been invented. And we notice that not one single member of the victorious army is dead or even wounded. Pathetic that thousands of years of ancient curses and spells could engender such an incompetent army of dog sand creatures. Several readers have argued with the rule in Ebert's little movie glossary that teaches us, no good movie has ever featured a hot air balloon. To be sure, there are exceptions, but The Mummy Returns is not one of them. Its hot air balloon looks like the ship that sailed to the land of Winken, Blinken and Nod. At one point, the action returns to London, and we see Tower Bridge, the Dome of St. Paul's and Big Ben clustered closely together in one shot. This is no doubt to make it easy for the geographically challenged. Perhaps adding a few snapshots from Madonna's wedding would not have been too much. The 1999 remake of The Mummy is personally one of my all-time favorite adventure entertainment movies ever made. But I'm not reviewing that film today. For this post, I'll be reviewing its 2001 sequel titled The Mummy Returns. Now it's no surprise that when Hollywood releases a hit summer blockbuster, there's bound to be a sequel, and in most cases the sequel has to be bigger and more epic. In this regard, The Mummy Returns definitely succeeds as a larger and more action-packed adventure film. However, being a bigger film obviously doesn't mean better. There was a time in which I hated this sequel and found it completely inferior to its predecessor, but over the years it's actually grown on me. Nowadays I look at The Mummy Returns as on par with, say, Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, which was the weakest of the original Indiana Jones films, but undeniably a fun adventure film that's worth repeated viewings. While I still have some issues with The Mummy Returns, it's still a perfectly satisfying adventure sequel. Our story begins with the origin of a sinister warrior only referred to as the Scorpion King. Back in ancient times, this evil soldier made a deal with the dark Egyptian god Anubis to take command of an immortal army that he would lead to conquer his enemies. After granting his wish, the god Anubis put both the Scorpion King and his army into a deep sleep at the base of a pyramid, hidden in the middle of a mystical oasis. All that remains is a golden bracelet which can lead anyone to the pyramid, where any worthy champion can challenge the Scorpion King in battle for the chance to take command of his immortal army. Back in the present, it's been 9 years since Rick and Evelyn Evie O'Connell defeated the mummy Imhotep in the previous film. While they've had a healthy relationship and raised a son, Evie is receiving mysterious visions. They lead our heroes to a temple, where they discover the golden bracelet of the Scorpion King. The bracelet soon latches itself onto their son Alex, making him a living guide to the hidden oasis. Meanwhile, the O'Connell's greatest foe Imhotep has been unearthed and revived by an evil sorceress named Mila, who is also the modern-day reincarnation of the mummy's ancient love Ankh-Su-Namun. With these two evil lovers reunited, they kidnap Alex and use him as their guide, as they aim to kill the scorpion kind and command his army. So the chase is on for our heroes to rescue their son, learn the secrets of the ancient past, and prevent this clash between two immortal titans. All the cast members from the previous film are back, some with improvements, while others have fallen by the wayside. Rachel Weisz still gives a strong leading performance in the role of Evie. On the flip side, Brendan Fraser is looking tired and is far less charming in the role of Rick O'Connell than he was in the previous film. The comedic side character Jonathan is starting to get grating, and even more pointless than before. The Magi warrior Ardith Bay is back from the first film, and he's just as awesome as ever, and really shines in some cool action scenes. The son Alex is your typical child character, nothing bad, but nothing special either. One thing that I have mixed feels about is how the characters are given deeper backstories. Rick, for example, has become some sort of prophesized hero that can slay the Scorpion King. Evie is revealed to be the reincarnation of an Egyptian princess named Nefertiti, who was the daughter of the very same pharaoh that was murdered by Imhotep during the flashback of the first movie. On the one hand, it takes quiet the suspension of disbelief that all these people came together like this. Yet, at the same time, all this added backstory does make the characters and their relation with the villains a lot more interesting. On that note, the film boasts quite the entertaining collection of different villains. Both old and new Arnold Vosloo reprises his signature role as the mummy Imhotep, and his performance is just as good as before. The only downside is that he spends a lot of time in his human form, and we don't get to see a cool evolutionary progression of his decayed body like we did in the previous movie. The evil sorceress Mila is another excellent villain, and played very well by Patricia Velasquez, who again is reprising her role from the first film. She steals the show with every scene she's in, and her character is even more heartless than the mummy himself, which makes her a lot more fun to hate. There's also a really cool evil henchman named Lok Nah, who's one of those menacing supporting villains that stands out with his own unique cool factor. The only villain I didn't care for is this one museum curator who leads a clan of bad guys with red hoods. This guy just felt like unnecessary added fluff, as we already had the mummy, the scorpion kind, the evil sorceries, and the nasty henchmen. Seriously, what did we need this guy for? Next, let's cover all the other positive aspects of the film, before I address the negatives. Looking back, I had honestly forgotten how much fun the action sequences are in this film, how busy they are, and how they come in a nice variety too. There's more gunplay, hand-to-hand combat, and lots of really cool sword fights. There's a scene in which our heroes are attacked by the skeleton warriors from the first film, which leads into a deeply thrilling chase on a double-decker bus. Also, there's not just one, but two catfights between our female leads, which both feature great fighting choreography, and two good-looking women fighting each other while dressed in skimpy, tight-body hugging outfits. This was one of the main selling images on the poster, and for obvious reasons. I also like that there's more traveling in this film, and lots of imaginative locations. This helps make the film feel more like an adventure, and it further expands on the mythos and lore of the mummy universe. I already loved the Egypt setting of the first film, but this movie goes even further with an expanded mythology and more ground to cover. The new instrumental music track was composed by Alan Silvestri, who's a very talented composer, and gives this film a worthy soundtrack that heightens the action and adventure elements of the film. There's also an original song titled "Forever May Not Be Long Enough," performed by Live, and it's actually a really cool song. The theme is admittedly out of context with the film, but it's still great to listen to, and somehow works along with a film in an Egyptian setting. Now it's time to cover the things that annoy me in this sequel. The first thing to note is that when compared to its predecessor, this film doesn't have much horror-related material. Granted, the first film was obviously an action-adventure film, but it also kept one foot firmly rooted in the horror genre. It had an occasionally eerie atmosphere and some creepy elements. Considering that our star villain is the mummy, it just feels more appropriate to have some kind balance between adventure and horror. The Mummy Returns is 100% adventure action, with some predictable second-rate jump scares thrown in. The closest the film ever gets to feeling like a horror film is this one scene where the decayed version of the mummy kills three people on a train to regain its human flesh. But even that is very mild. A lot of the CGI, while impressive for the time, has become very dated, with noticeable green screen effects and cartoony monsters. We do at least get a nice variety of new creatures, including an army of dingo-faced soldiers and nasty midget mummies. Like many sequels, this film has a really bad habit of recreating scenes and making direct references to the first film. Remember that scene when the mummy created a giant sandstorm that formed his face? Well, he's doing it again with water. Remember that funny joke with the objects falling over in a domino effect? Well, this film does it again. Lather, rinse, and repeat. I'd call it a nitpick, but the film is constantly recreating memorable scenes from its predecessor, as if it's scared to have an identity of its own. The self-referential Hummer is also really tired in this film. Actually, a lot of the comedy is borderline silly. This especially applies to Brendan Fraser, whose deadpan delivery gets very annoying. Also, the first film had this humble old-school look and feel, whereas this film feels more polished and modern, with slow motion and way too much wire work during the action. One minor announce that always gets to me in other films is when a main character dies and is then brought back at the end. Yes, there's a scene in this film when one of my favorite characters actually dies, and while I'm happy to see said character come back, it also defeats the drama and just feels pointless. The adventure comes to a close with an epic climax, which harkens back to the style of a Star Wars finale, as we watch multiple action sequences at once. Rick battles Imhotep in an exciting final battle, Evie gets into another sword fight with Mila, and Ardeth leads his Magi army into battle against the army of Anubis. It all keeps building to the long-awaited resurrection of the monstrous Scorpion King. His design is outstanding, as he's a giant scorpion-slash-human hybrid, but unfortunately the CGI effects that bring him to life are some of the worst I've ever seen. It's still a really cool final battle, and there's one standout moment that's almost Oscar-worthy. Said moment being when both Rick and Imhotep are about to be dragged into hell, and each yells out a different plea to the woman they love, only for both women to do the complete opposite of what they were told. This scene was beautifully shot, very well acted, and leads to the most touching bit of human emotion as conveyed by our main villain just before he dies. Shortly after The Mummy Returns came a spin-off movie titled The Scorpion King, which was also silly, but a harmlessly derivative adventure film. I definitely have more to say about that film, but I'll save it for my next review. Then there was The Mummy, the animated series, which ran for 2 seasons on Kids WB. This series continued the adventures of the O'Connell family and featured a whole gallery of new villains and mystical creatures for them to encounter. I remember watching it and liking it okay, but it really wasn't that memorable either. Then in 2008 came a third film titled The Mummy, Tomb of the Dragon Emperor, and this one was really bad. In an effort to further expand on the mummy universe, this film flew way too close to the sun and became an unorganized, boring mess. Its one saving grace was an awesome final battle climax, with armies of mummies battling hordes of zombies. It's pretty sweet. Unfortunately, the characters are worse than ever, and there isn't even an ounce of spooky material. Every single problem I had with The Mummy Returns is multiplied by 20, and leaving us fans with a hollow and empty shell of a sequel that doesn't even feel like it's from the same franchise. The Mummy Returns is often described as a lesser sequel, but when compared to everything else that came after, it really isn't that bad. In fact, I'd go so far as to say that The Mummy Returns works just fine as an entertaining and mostly complete sequel. It develops the characters further, explores the universe more, and features some of the franchise's best action sequences. While it's still dated and brought down by some noticeable problems, it's by no means terrible. If fun Saturday afternoon fodder is all you want, then this sequel delivers the goods and is a mostly entertaining experience. Other information about this film. The Mummy Returns in a very big way. Considerably more elaborate and spectacular in its special effects than was the film that brought Universal's musty corpse back to life 2 years ago. This follow-up still lacks the wit and elan that would have made this burgeoning series more than a popcorn picture franchise. But the widescreen here virtually bursts with visual goodies, and writer-director Steven Sommers scarcely allows the actors, or the audience, a moment to take a breath during the non-stop action of the final hour. The original unearthed more than $414 million worldwide, and there is no reason this one shouldn't follow suit. With all the key personnel intact from the initial installment, the new film similarly operates most successfully on a 12-year-old, comic book appeal level. Once again, the dialogue is hokey. Every crisis is too easily dealt with, and the whole enterprise lacks the flair and sophistication that made Raiders of the Lost Ark just as appealing to adults as it was to kids. Perhaps unequipped to eradicate these problems, Sommers has fixed on the alternative solution of minimizing them, essentially by filling the screen with so many dazzling sights and distracting incidents that one's grown-up self is eventually persuaded to step aside to allow the little kid inside if it's not too mummified to have a good time. Sommers and company must have felt liberated by the success of the first venture, for the visions of mythical antiquity they bring to often ridiculous but undeniably eye-catching life are vastly grander this time around. The hidden door secret passageway magic bracelet don't open this box, if you know what's good for you trappings are straight out of B-movies. But the sheer spectacle of swarms of scorpions rising from the sand, mummy warriors marauding through the streets of London, a homemade dirigible puttering through deep ravines on its way to a gleaming golden pyramid in a hidden jungle, and an army, as big as the desert, of ancient warrior hounds descending over the dunes, all accomplished with extraordinary visual credibility, puts the film toward the high end of visual effects-driven experiences. The plot, of course, is just a pretext to get the mummy and his minions alive and jumping again. It's 1933, 8 years after the action of the last picture. In the interim, Yank adventurer Rick O'Connell, Brendan Fraser, and Egyptologist Evelyn Rachel Weisz have married and produced a kid, Alex Freddy Both, who's to the manner born in that, on his first foray into a shadowy Egyptian tomb, he emerges with a golden bracelet that everybody wants. Once again, Rick and Evelyn must contend with the resurrected 3-year-old mummy Imhotep Arnold Vosloo, who emerges from his slumber in crusty condition only to once again assume superhuman strength. Reunited with his long-ago love, Ankh-Su Namun, reincarnated as Mila Patricia Velasquez, Imhotep is determined to at last rule the world through control of the enormous army of the Scorpion King World Wrestling Federation star The Rock, a fearsome warrior who has been waiting in limbo for 5,000 years to claim the total victory for which he sold his soul to Anubis. If the Scorpion King is allowed to reawaken, Imhotep will have quite a fight on his hands. After this backstory is laid out by way of a furious but conspicuously bloodless battle in ancient Thebes, Rick, Evelyn, and Alex are pursued to their London mansion by Imhotep's earthly cronies, an exotic band led by Mila and Lok Na Edwale Akinoy Agbage, a turbaned sword twirler single-mindedly devoted to detaching Alex from the coveted gold bracelet. Unless they prevent it, the baddies warn, the Scorpion King will arise from the dead in 7 days, starting a chain reaction that could start the next apocalypse. After a lot of boisterousness involving some flashy hand-to-hand combat, Evelyn's ritual near sacrifice in the bowels of the British Museum, a wild nocturnal chase on a double-decker bus, and Alex's kidnapping, the action returns to Egypt, where the Scorpion King's imminent return has everybody in a dither. From this point on, the plot is yanked this way and that in order to create virtually no downtime in the dizzying succession of action and fight scenes, whose number would have more than filled an entire 15-episode Republic serial. Rick Evelyn, the latter's brother Jonathan John Hanna, back for more comic relief, in the broadest sense of the term, and the mysterious Ardith Bay Oded Fayer, also returning, wise in the ways of the desert and its lore, hire a boat-like dirigible that carries them over the desert in search of Alex and his abductors. In the course of the race to the legendary Golden Pyramid, which, of course, no man has ever seen and lived to tell of it, Imhotep sends a wall of water roaring through a gorge to engulf the dirigible. Nasty pygmy mummies chase everyone through the underbrush of the forest surrounding the pyramid. Evelyn and Mila, in their ancient and reincarnated personas, get to enact not one but two beautifully choreographed dagger fights. Evelyn is killed well, maybe. Rick must battle both Imhotep and the Scorpion King. And, best of all, from a spectacle POV, Ardith Bay's dramatically black-garbed soldiers face off in the desert against the terrifying canine army of Anubis. Fans of The Rock probably will get more laughs than thrills out of the wrestler's feature film debut, in which his head and torso have been grafted onto a giant scorpion's body. A pretty silly sight, to be sure. But at least he doesn't have to deliver any dialogue, which is not Sommers' strong suit. Fraser, looking slightly bulkier than he did in the original, remains ideally suited for this sort of lighthearted fun, although his character feels sidelined more than before in favor of the attention given to the even more numerous supporting players. Of the latter, Vosloo, Velasquez, Akinoy Agbage, and Fair take the most advantage of the opportunities. Their dashing looks cutting striking figures against the exotic comic book backdrops. Pick's strongest suit is its visual splendor, achieved through a virtually seamless melding of impressive sets, great locations in Morocco, Egypt, and Jordan, colorful costumes, and first-rate CGI work by Industrial Light and Magic and visual effects supervised by John Burton. Alan Silvestri's energetic score reps an improvement on Jerry Goldsmith's laborious musical support for the first installment. The 1999 remake of the horror classic, The Mummy, surprised Universal Pictures with its box office success. The studio had expected it to be profitable, but not that profitable. However, long before the worldwide gross crept close to $400 million, Universal had already put two additional Mummy films into the hopper, awarding the series the franchise label. The Mummy Returns, which reunites nearly the entire cast from the 1999 movie, is the first of these two productions. The other, a prequel called The Scorpion King, will be released either later this year or next year, depending on how Universal arranges its release schedule. Stephen Sommers' 1999 feature was an enjoyable, if overlong, romp recounting the struggles of an adventurer and his companions to stop the apocalyptic agenda of an ancient Egyptian priest. While not entirely successful, The Mummy nevertheless boasted an infectious blend of high adventure, low-scare horror, and special effects that transformed it into a crowd-pleaser capable of sating the early summer audience until The Phantom Menace came along a few weeks later. Now, Rick O'Connell, Brendan Fraser, Evie O'Connell, Rachel Weisz, Jonathan Carnahan, John Hanna, Ardith Bay, Oded Fayer, and of course Imhotep Arnold Vosloo are all back. Joining them are a couple of notable newcomers, Rick and Evie's son, Alex Freddy both, and the dreaded Scorpion King WWF mainstay, The Rock. The story for The Mummy Returns is a meager and muddled affair peppered with Deus Ex Machina contrivances. A cult of power-mad Egyptologists, is there another kind, have concocted a plan by which they can obtain world domination. First, they must resurrect Imhotep, the mummy from the first film, since they are being led by the ancient priest's reincarnated girlfriend, Ankh-Su-Namun Patricia Velazquez. This proves to be surprisingly easy. Then, with his powers restored, Imhotep heads off to do battle with the mythical Scorpion King, whose tomb lies in a pyramid at the center of a hidden oasis. In order to find that oasis, Imhotep needs an artifact which happens to be in the possession of Alex O'Connell. And when the boy is kidnapped, that brings his parents, his uncle Jonathan, and their old friend, Ardith Bay, into the conflict. This results in a lot of chasing around the globe and a climax that features a special effects-laden battle between a large force of humans and an army of decaying, dog-faced creatures. The fundamental problem underlying The Mummy Returns is the reason that the movie exists in the first place. This is not the byproduct of the creative process. It's an offshoot of Universal Pictures' greed. The sequel was made not because the filmmakers had a compelling story to tell, but because The Mummy made so much money that a second installment became mandatory. This thought process results in countless pointless and derivative sequels, a class in which The Mummy Returns unquestionably belongs. The plot is just a flimsy excuse to bring back old friends and stick them in a series of cliffhangers. It's low-rent Raiders of the Lost Ark, with high-quality special effects filling in for character development and intelligible storytelling. Some of the action sequences in The Mummy Returns are fun, and the visual effects are more polished and less noticeably fake than in the previous film. Unfortunately, all of this can't obscure the fact that there is basically no plot. The clash of armies at the end has no purpose beyond showing off the effects maven's skills at the computer. In terms of style, it's reminiscent of the war in The Phantom Menace, albeit without the same strong story motivation. The Mummy Returns has opportunities to do interesting things at one point. There's a chance to force Imhotep and Rick into an uneasy alliance, but that is neatly bypassed. Like the Indiana Jones movies, The Mummy Returns tries to blend low-key humor with a non-stop series of cliffhangers. However, while some of the jokes are funny, the action sequences are only sporadically satisfying, owing primarily to their often preposterous resolutions. And, while Rick possesses a certain charm, he's no Indiana Jones. Brendan Fraser and Rachel Weisz rekindle the cute chemistry that existed between their characters in The Mummy. Freddie Booth makes an effective addition to the cast, primarily because he's not as annoying as most movie kids. John Hannah is back as the fatuous Jonathan. Arnold Vosloo's Imhotep is subtly diminished, perhaps because he now has to share the spotlight with two other villains. Patricia Velasquez has an expanded role here from the one she essayed in the first film, and the part of the Scorpion King doesn't challenge the Rock's thespian abilities. All he has to do is snarl and look tough, things he is familiar with from his day job. The Mummy Returns offers one surprise and unexpectedly poignant dramatic moment in which we feel a surge of sympathy for one of the characters. Unfortunately, it's for one of the bad guys, which makes the ending a downer. Overall, the film probably offers what fans of The Mummy are expecting. The thinner, unnecessarily long storyline notwithstanding, this is essentially more of the same. It's hollow, lightweight entertainment, not unpleasant, but far from the Sommers' definitive action-adventure flick. More details. 7 years after defeating the mummy Imhotep Arnold Vosloo, Rick Brendan Fraser and Evelyn O'Connell Rachel Weisz are dragged back into the action when forces working to resurrect Imhotep kidnap their 6-year-old son and take him to Egypt. Hot in pursuit, Rick and Evelyn race to prevent Imhotep and his servants from reviving the dreaded Scorpion King Dwayne Johnson and seizing control of the army of Anubis. The Mummy Returns is a lot of things. Ostensibly, it is a 2001 sequel to the surprise 1999 hit The Mummy. It is also a textbook example of how to cripple a nascent movie franchise, a showcase of overambitious and woefully mishandled visual effects, an egregious abuse of popular Egyptian mythology, and more than anything else, a stern lesson for Hollywood that rushing a film to meet a predetermined release date will never end well. Many of the ingredients that made the 1999 film a delight are retained. Brendan Fraser still plays his entertaining matinee idol role with warmth and humor. Odid Fayer still infuses the Magi swordsman Ardeth Bey with gravitas and dignity, and a neat underlying lightness. Arnold Vosloo still gives the villainous Imhotep a strong, muscular edge. The orchestral score Alan Silvestri replaces Jerry Goldsmith continues to emphasize a classically old-fashioned atmosphere of stirring adventure. Beyond this, the film really is all over the place. The plot manages to be both overly complicated and weirdly arbitrary. It begins by introducing a new villain, the Scorpion King, in ancient Egypt. He tries to invade and fails miserably. And at the point of death, while exiled to the desert, he makes a bargain with Anubis to gain supernatural powers and control over a magical army of ferocious dog people. A quick note to the writers, the evil god they were looked for was Set, not Anubis, and even then he was a god of chaos rather than evil. Once the Scorpion King succeeds in his invasion, his soul is taken by Anubis and the dog army dissolves to sand. That's the problem with deals with gods, I suppose. There's always the pesky fine print. It should be noted that The Mummy Returns was Dwayne Johnson's first significant dramatic role, following guest appearances on the TV shows The Net and Star Trek. Voyager, and his lack of experience at this early career stage is painfully clear. Cut to 1933, and the O'Connells are now married with a son named Alex Freddy Both. Both was 9 when he shot The Mummy Returns, but his character can only be 6 given the timeline between first film and sequel. In the actor's defense, he's a far less risible than the typical kid sidekick in these sorts of films. That said, the character is still a painful irritant on the rest of the film. A more cleanly structured sequel might have allocated his story role. He gets irreparably attached to a bracelet that leads to the Scorpion King's lair to his mother Evelyn, which would have both removed the annoying child stereotype and given Rachel Weisz more material with which to work. The O'Connells find the bracelet. Alex gets it attached to his wrist. Imhotep is raised by the reincarnation of his long-dead lover Ankh Su Namlin Patricia Velasquez. Rick is revealed as a prophesied warrior of Egyptian legend. Evelyn is revealed as the reincarnation of the princess Nefertiti. Everyone races to the fabled oasis of Om Shir, and Rick and Imhotep battle one another in a pyramid to defeat the revived Scorpion King and either control or dispel the army of Anubis. It is a narrative mess, and shows a remarkably rushed and inattentive scripting process. If the script feels rushed, it has nothing on the film's visual effects. The Mummy Returns is an enormously ambitious film, with a CGI list of requirements that includes undead warriors, forests sprouting from deserts, zombie pygmies, thousands of dog warriors, and a climactic half-man, half-scorpion monster. There is not a single visual effect in the film that does not look substandard and rushed. The Scorpion King in particular is an embarrassment to the whole film. Industrial Light and Magic famously begged Universal Pictures to delay the film's release by 6 months so that they could do a proper job. But a fixed release date was considered more important than a decent film. It all but kills the film. One could possibly overcome the weak writing and flabby narrative if there were some dramatic and visually engaging action sequences and chases, but it all collapses to pieces. It is an enormous shame. The 1999 Mummy presented a wonderfully entertaining blend of adventure, comedy, and horror, and could easily have been the foundation of a sustained and commercially successful franchise. Instead, The Mummy got killed stone dead with its second installment. It was another 7 years before Universal returned with a modified cast and a new director to make The Mummy, Tomb of the Dragon Emperor. After that, the studio cut its losses and aimed for a complete reboot. Is The Mummy Returns the worst sequel imaginable? Of course not, but if you asked if it was one of the most disappointing, that leads to a different answer. The Mummy, the 1999 remake of the 1932 horror film, proved to be a major success for filmmakers Stephen Sommers and Universal Studios. 2 years later, both the director and the studio reunited its major stars for a sequel set a decade later. In doing so, Sommers and Universal created a 4-movie franchise. Like the first film, The Mummy Returns began thousands of years ago, in ancient Egypt. However, this flashback focused on an Egyptian mercenary named Matthias, who makes an unsuccessful attempt to conquer the land. He and his army is exiled to the desert of Om Shir, where most of them die from heat exhaustion, except for Matthias. The latter offers his soul to the god Anubis for the power to defeat his enemies. The latter creates an oasis called Om Shir to hide the newly dubbed Scorpion King's pyramid and gives the latter a legion of humanoid jackal warriors to seek revenge. The army of Anubis sweeps across Egypt, destroying everything in its path. But once their task is finished, Anubis claims the Scorpion King's soul and his army. The movie jumps to the year 1933, which finds the O'Connell family Rick, Evelyn Evie, and their son Alex exploring the ruins of Thebes. Evie and Rick discover the bracelet of Anubis, unaware that Alex has stumbled across a trio of mercenaries attempting to take the bracelet for themselves. The family returns home to England, and unbeknownst to his parents, Alex tries on the bracelet and experiences a vision with directions to the oasis of Alm Shir. Unfortunately, a group of Egyptian cultists, who had hired the three thugs, invades the O'Connell estate and kidnaps Evie. The O'Connell's old comrade, the Magi warrior Ardith Bey, arrives to help, but is unable to prevent Evie's kidnapping. The cultists take her to the British Museum, where they resurrect the body of Egyptian high priest and sorcerer Imhotep. They plan to use his power to defeat the sorcerer king. Rick, his brother-in-law Jonathan Carnahan, Alex and Ardith arrive at the museum to rescue Evie. After the O'Connells, Jonathan and Ardith manage to escape the army of mummified soldiers. Alex, who is still wearing the Anubis bracelet, is kidnapped by the cultists. The four adults track him to Egypt, where they recruit the help of Rick's old World War I friend, Izzy Buttons, to rescue Alex from Imhotep and the cultists and prevent them from reviving the army of Anubis. I usually dislike horror films, but I noticed that the 1999 movie, The Mummy, seemed more like an adventure film in the style of the Indiana Jones movie franchise. I could say the same about The Mummy Returns. And considering my dislike of horror films, I say, thank God. However, the movie has enough elements to satisfy those who love this particular genre. This was especially apparent in the scenes that featured Imhotep's murder of the three mercenaries, the O'Connell's battle against the High Priest's mummified soldiers during the bus ride through London, and during the finale sequence inside the Scorpion King's pyramid at Alm Shir. The sight of the Scorpion King as a transformed centaurid or scorpion monster was enough to give me the heebie-jeebies. But if I had to select the one sequence that truly captured aspects of the horror genre, it was the one that featured the O'Connell's attack upon the cultists in the Alm Shir jungle that I found particularly off-putting. Not only did the movie's heroes have to attack the cultists in order to save Alex, both sides of the conflict had to deal the pygmy mummies that attacked and killed anyone or any army that marched through the jungle. What can I say? Those pygmies really freaked me out. The Mummy Returns did feature a good deal of action sequences that seemed more like an adventure than a horror story, thank goodness. The O'Connells' escape from the flooding of the Thebes Pyramid, their escape from Imhotep's attempt to drown them with a tsunami wave, their escape from the destruction of the Alm Shir Pyramid, and various hand-to-hand fight sequences thankfully reminded me that The Mummy Returns was more of an adventure story. Also, Stephen Sommers provided a great deal of rich characterization and humor in his screenwriter. Like the 1999 film, The Mummy Returns featured some sophomoric humor. But if I must be honest, a good deal of the humor seemed sharper and wittier this particular film, especially in the hands of one particular character, Izzy Buttons. In fact, my favorite line in the film came him. "Whatever it is, whatever you need, I don't care. Forget it, O'Connell. Every time I hook up with you, I get shot. Last time, I got shot in the ass. I'm in mourning for my ass." I never mentioned this in my review of The Mummy, but I was also impressed by Sommers' handling of the sequence featuring Imhotep's background and introduction at the beginning of the film. The opening sequence featuring the Scorpion King's introduction struck me as mediocre. But I was very impressed by the flashback sequence about Evelyn's past life in the form of the Princess Nefertiti and her witness of her father, Pharaoh Seti I. Sommers has a real talent for costumed melodrama, and it would be nice to see him exploit it in the fullest in his career. This sequence also featured a first-rate fight scene between Rachel Weisz's Nefertiti and Patricia Velasquez's Ankh Su-Namun. Of course, one cannot talk about The Mummy Returns without bringing up its visual effects. First of all, kudos to cinematographer Adrian Biddle for continuing the beautiful photography for which he was responsible in the first film. I especially enjoyed his work in the sequence that featured the parallel journeys across Egypt by both the O'Connell and Imhotep parties. Alan Cameron and his crew did an excellent job in recreating not only England and Egypt of the early 1930s, but also ancient Egypt. the team of Ahmed Abounaum, Giles Masters and Tony Reading added a great deal to Cameron's work with their beautiful and colorful art designs. I have always enjoyed Alan Silvestri's music in past movies, but I must admit that I really appreciated his use of Middle Eastern or North African style in the movie's score. I do admire the special effects created by the movie's visual effects team. I was especially impressed by their work in the Om Shir jungle sequence. However, there were times I found it a bit over the top. I noticed that Sommers hired his costume designer from the last film, John Bloomfield, to design the costumes for this film, and I wish to God he had hired someone else. I had no problem with Bloomfield's costumes for the ancient Egypt sequences. His costume designs for the 1933 scenes, namely the costumes for the female characters, were another matter. Honestly, they sucked. I was far from impressed by Bloomfield's recreation of 1920s fashion for Evelyn's character in the 1999 movie. His recreation of early 1930s fashions for the female characters were just as bad as shown in the images below. I can only shake my head in disbelief. The above were Bloomfield's idea of 1932-33 women's fashion. Really, they looked more like a modern-day take on the fashions of that particular era. The fact that both Weisz and Velasquez are sporting modern hairstyles does not help. At least I cannot complain about the acting. An episode of Star Trek Voyager featured the first project in which Dwayne Johnson portrayed a character other than himself. He had nothing to do but engage in a fight scene. The Mummy Returns featured his second role in which he portrayed another character. Again, he had no lines. At least Sommers managed to effectively direct him into expressing his character via body language. The other cast members, on the other hand, had speaking lines. The movie featured solid performances from the likes of Bruce Byron, Joe Dixon, and Tom Fisher as the three thugs hired by the cultists to assist them. Alun Armstrong gave a surprisingly effective performance as Mr. Hafez, the leader of the Egyptian cultists. Unlike most Western actors, Armstrong managed to portray a non-Western villain without resorting to theatrical acting. My favorite performance came from Sean Parks, who was both hysterically witty as O'Connell's old friend, Izzy Buttons. I usually have mixed feelings about child actors, but I must admit that I enjoyed Freddie Both's engaging performance as Rick and Evelyn's boisterous son, Alex. The Mummy Returns was the first movie or television production I had noticed Edwale Akinoye Agbaje, and his performance as Mr. Hafez's chief enforcer, Lok Na, was, well, magnificent. In fact, I could say the same about his screen presence. Patricia Velasquez may not have been the world's greatest actress, and there were times I found her verbal performance as Femme Fatale Mila Nyes and ancient Egyptian courtesan Ankh Su-Namun a bit limited. She more than made up this flaw with a strong ability for silent acting and a very impressive screen presence. Again, she proved to have a great screen chemistry with Arnold Vassalou, who returned as the Egyptian high priest, Imhotep. What can I say about Vassalou's performance? The man is Imhotep both in presence and performance. He did a marvelous job in conveying both the frightening aspects of his character and the latter's passionate love for Ankh Su-Namun. Happily, Odid Fayer reprised his role as Medjay warrior Ardeth Bey. And not only was he great, as always, for the first time, I became aware of Fayer's talent for comedic acting. John Hannah was as funny as ever as Evelyn's ne'er-do-well older brother, Jonathan Carnahan. I found him especially funny in his scenes with Both and Parks. Rachel Weisz reprised her role as Evelyn Evie Carnahan O'Connell, and I was surprised by the level of development in her character. Weisz did an excellent job in conveying the mature development of Evie and maintaining the character's familiar quirks at the same. Weisz was also excellent as the Princess Nefertiti, who was not only fervently protective of her father, but also suspicious of Ankh Su-Namun. The character of Rick O'Connell also struck me as surprisingly different in this movie. Like Evelyn, marriage and parenthood had developed him into a more mature personality. And like Evelyn, he also maintained some of his personality quirks. and Brendan Fraser did an excellent job in conveying both the familiar and different aspects of Rick's character. The Mummy Returns effectively continued the exciting adventure and horror of the 1999 film, thanks to Stephen Sommers' writing and direction. And I enjoyed it very much, along with the entertaining performances of the cast led by Brendan Fraser and Rachel Weisz. But as much as I continue to enjoy it, there is a part of me that wished Sommers had not been so over the top with some of his direction and the special effects featured in the movie. It seemed as if he was trying to outdo his work in the first film. And sometimes, that is not a good thing. The Mummy Returns is a 2001 American action fantasy film written and directed by Stephen Sommers, starring Brendan Fraser, Rachel Weisz, John Hannah, Arnold Vosloo, Odette Fehr, Patricia Velasquez, Freddie Both, Alun Armstrong, and Dwayne Johnson in his film acting debut. The film is a sequel to the 1999 film The Mummy, and was distributed by Universal Pictures. The Mummy Returns inspired the 2002 prequel film The Scorpion King, a spin-off that is set 5,000 years prior and whose eponymous character, played by Dwayne Johnson The Rock, was introduced in this film. Like its predecessor, The Mummy Returns was a commercial success despite receiving mixed reviews. Movie plot. In 3067 BC, a fearsome warrior known as the Scorpion King leads an army to conquer the world. However, they are eventually defeated and exiled to the desert of Almshir. Dying, the Scorpion King vows to give Anubis his soul in return for the power to defeat his enemies. Anubis accepts, magically conjuring an oasis and golden pyramid, and giving the Scorpion King an army of jackal-like warriors to conquer Egypt. However, once his task is finished, Anubis claims the Scorpion King's soul, and the army is returned to the underworld. In 1933 AD, Rick O'Connell and his wife, Evelyn, explore ancient ruins with their son, Alex, finding the bracelet of Anubis. In London, the bracelet locks onto Alex, showing him visions directing him to Almshir. Evelyn is attacked and captured by a cult who resurrect Imhotep with the Book of the Dead. They wish to use his power to defeat the Scorpion King, which would give them command of Anubis' army. The cult, led by museum curator Baltus Hafez, includes enforcer Lok Na and Mila Nyes, the physical reincarnation of Imhotep's love Ankh Su-Namun. Rick and Alex set out to rescue Evelyn with the help of her brother Jonathan, who had gotten his hands on a mysterious golden scepter, and the Magi Ardith Bey, who has returned to help them. Rick frees Evelyn after a massive battle, but Alex is soon kidnapped and forced to lead the cult with his visions from the bracelet. The O'Connells pursue them with Rick's associate Izzy. Along the way, Alex leaves clues for his parents, who follow in Izzy's dirigible. Imhotep uses the Book of the Dead to restore Ankh Su-Namun's soul into Mila's body, but by doing so, he unwittingly allows Evelyn to unlock the memories of her previous life as Princess Nefertiti, the bracelet's keeper and Pharaoh Seti I's daughter. At the edge of the oasis, Imhotep realizes they are being pursued and uses his magic to crash the dirigible. Izzy stays behind to repair it. The O'Connells infiltrate the cult, but both groups are attacked by pygmy mummies. Rick retrieves Alex while Ardith kills Lok Na. They escape the pygmies, who kill all the cult members except for Hafez, Imhotep, and Ankh Su-Namun. The O'Connells arrive at the pyramid, and the bracelet detaches from Alex. Ankh Su-Namun, Imhotep, and Hafez then arrive and kill Evelyn before entering the pyramid. Inside the pyramid, Imhotep's powers are taken from him, forcing him to face the Scorpion King as a mortal. Hafez uses the bracelet to conjure Anubis' army, which appears outside of the oasis. Rick finds Imhotep summoning the Scorpion King and attacks him. The Scorpion King, now an enormous scorpion monster, interrupts the fight. Imhotep tricks him into attacking Rick while outside, Ardith and the Magi battle Anubis's resurrected army. While Rick and the Scorpion King fight, Hafez is caught in the melee and killed. Meanwhile, Jonathan and Alex steal the Book of the Dead from Ankh Su-Namun and use it to resurrect Evelyn. Rick discovers hieroglyphs explaining that Jonathan's scepter is the mystical spear of Osiris. With the help of Jonathan and the resurrected Evelyn, Rick gets the scepter and uses it to slay the Scorpion King, sending him and the army back into the underworld. As the oasis begins to implode and the pyramid crumbles, Rick and Imhotep cling to the ledge of a pit that leads to the underworld. Rick implores Evelyn to escape before it is too late, but she risks her life to pull Rick to safety. Seeing this, Imhotep pleads for Ankh-Su-Namun to do the same, but she abandons him. Heartbroken, Imhotep lets go and falls into the underworld. While fleeing, Ankh-Su-Namun inadvertently falls into a pit of scorpions, killing her. At the last moment, Izzy arrives with a modified dirigible and rescues the O'Connells just before the oasis and the pyramid are destroyed, though not before Jonathan swipes the pyramid's diamond capstone. They depart into the sunset, with Ardeth Bay saluting them before riding off. Cast: Brendan Fraser as Rick O'Connell, a treasure hunter and former legionnaire. Rachel Weisz as Evelyn O'Connell Nefertiri, respectively, Rick's wife, and the daughter of Pharaoh Seti I. John Hanna as Jonathan Carnahan, Evelyn's brother. Arnold Vosloo as Imhotep, High Priest of Osiris and lover of Ankh-Su-Namun. Oded Fehr as Ardeth Bay, a Magi chieftain and warrior. Patricia Velasquez as Mila Nye's Ankh-Su-Namun, the mistress of Pharaoh Seti I and secret lover of Imhotep. Freddie Boeuf as Alex O'Connell, Rick and Evelyn's son. Dwayne Johnson as Matthias of Akkad, the Scorpion King, an ancient warrior who sold his soul to Anubis. Alun Armstrong as Baltus Hafez, the cult leader. Adwael Akinoy Agbage as Loch Nau, a cult enforcer. Sean Parks as Izzy Buttons, Rick's friend and a dirigible pilot. Bruce Byron as Red Willits, a thief contracted by the cult to claim the bracelet of Anubis. Joe Dixon as Jacques, a thief contracted by the cult to claim the bracelet of Anubis. Tom Fisher as Spivey, a thief contracted by the cult to claim the bracelet of Anubis. Aharon Ipalay as Pharaoh Seti I, the Pharaoh of Egypt, whom Imhotep killed in 1290 BC. Music: The Mummy Returns, original motion picture soundtrack, was released on May 1, 2001 by Decca Records. It contains the score composed and conducted by Alan Silvestri, as well as a version of the song Forever May Not Be Long Enough by the rock band Live, which slightly differs from the song's album version. A 2-CD expansion was released by Intrada Records in 2018. Box office: The Mummy Returns earned $23.4 million on its first day of release, then made $26.8 million the day after. This made it the highest Friday and Saturday grosses, surpassing both Toy Story 2 and The Lost World, Jurassic Park respectively. Later that year, those records were simultaneously given to Planet of the Apes and Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. During its opening weekend, the film made $68.1 million, making it the second highest opening weekend of all time, only behind The Lost World, Jurassic Park. Moreover, it surpassed Hannibal to have the highest opening weekend for a 2001 film, joining Monsters, Inc., Rush Hour 2 and Planet of the Apes to become one of the only four films of that year to make $60 million in their first 3 days of release. The film also became one of four consecutive Universal films of the year to cross the $40 million in an opening weekend, with the others being American Pie 2, The Fast and the Furious and Jurassic Park Roman 3. The Mummy Returns would remain in the number one spot at the box office for 2 weeks until Shrek took it. The film grossed $202 million in the United States and Canada box offices and $233 million internationally, grossing over $435 million worldwide, making it the seventh highest grossing film of 2001. Critical response: The Mummy Returns received mixed reviews from critics. It currently holds a 46% rating on Rotten Tomatoes based on 141 reviews, with an average rating of 5.3. The site's consensus states, in The Mummy Returns, the special effects are impressive, but the characters seem secondary to the computer-generated imagery. Metacritic reported an average rating of 48 out of 100 based on 31 reviews, indicating mixed or average reviews. Audiences polled by CinemaScore gave the film an average grade of A on an A+ to F scale. Roger Ebert, who awarded the first film 3 stars, gave the second film only 2, saying that the mistake of The Mummy Returns is to abandon the characters and to use the plot only as a clothesline for special effects and action sequences. James Berardinelli of Real Views gave the film 2.5 stars out of 4, calling it hollow, lightweight entertainment not unpleasant, but far from the Sommers' definitive action-adventure flick. Kenneth Turan of the Los Angeles Times gave the film a positive review, praising its constant plot turns, cheeky sensibility, and omnipresent action sequences. Todd McCarthy of Variety praised the non-stop action of the final hour, saying that it bursts with visual goodies. Joe Morgenstern of the Wall Street Journal gave the film a negative review, saying that it has all of the clank but none of the swank of the previous version. Charles Taylor of Salon.com was also not impressed, calling The Mummy Returns everything the first Mummy was fun for not being. Home Media. The Mummy Returns debuted on VHS and DVD on October 2, 2001. It would become the fastest-selling DVD ever in the United States, with 2 million copies being sold after its first week. This record would be taken by Star Wars, Episode I: The Phantom Menace, just 2 weeks later. The film was subsequently released on the high-definition Blu-ray format in July 2008, and on OOD Blu-ray in 2017. Video games. 2 video games based on the movie were released. The first was released on the Game Boy Color, developed by GameBrains, and was released within the film's theatrical release. The other is for the PlayStation 2, developed by Blitz Games, and was released in October 2001, to coincide with the film's home media release. Both titles were published by Universal Interactive. The Mummy Returns movie review. It is a curiosity of movie action that too much of it can be boring. Imagine yourself on a roller coaster for 2 hours. After the first 10 minutes, the thrills subside. The mistake of The Mummy Returns is to abandon the characters and to use the plot only as a clothesline for special effects and action sequences. If it were not for references to The Mummy 1999, this sequel would hardly have a plot at all. 9 years have passed. Brendan Fraser is back again as Egyptologist Rick O'Connell, and Rachel Weisz, the librarian he met in the first film, is now his wife. They have an 8-year-old son named Alex Freddy Both. Also back are John Hannah as the twitty brother-in-law Jonathan and Arnold Vosloo as the mummy Imhotep, whose name sounds more than ever like an ancient Egyptian chain of pancake houses. Odid Fayer is the worried sage Ardith Bey, who begins sentences ominously with, "It is written that." Until Rick finally snaps, "Where is all this written?" A good question, since much of the story involves a magical pyramid of which it is written, no one who has seen it has ever returned alive. That logically leads us to wonder how they ever found out about it. But logic applied to this movie will drive you mad. So will any attempt to summarize the plot. So I will be content with various observations. The ads give The Rock, the World Wrestling Federation star, equal billing with Fraser. This is bait and switch. To call his appearance a cameo would be stretching it. He appears briefly at the beginning of the movie, is transmuted into a kind of transparent skeletal wraith, and disappears until the end of the film, when he comes back as the dreaded Scorpion King. I am not sure, at the end, if we see the real Rock or merely his face, connected to computer-generated effects. His scorpion is blown up to giant size, which has the unfortunate effect of making him look more like a lobster tail than a scorpion. I continue to believe The Rock has an acting career ahead of him, and after seeing this movie, I believe it is still ahead of him. Alex, the kid, adds a lot to the movie by acting just like a kid. I particularly enjoyed it when he was kidnapped by a fearsome adversary of his parents, chained and taken on a long journey, during which he drove his captor crazy by incessantly asking, "Are we there yet?" The dialogue, "You have started a chain reaction that could bring about the next apocalypse," is fascinating. Apparently, we missed the first apocalypse, which does not speak well for it. I have written before of the ability of movie characters to outrun fireballs. In The Mummy Returns, there is a more amazing feat. If the rising sun touches little Alex while he is wearing the magical bracelet, he will die, it is written. But Rick, carrying Alex in his arms, is able to outrace the sunrise. We see the line of sunlight moving on the ground right behind them. It is written by Eratosthenes that the Earth is about 25,000 miles around. And since there are 24 hours in a day, Rick was running approximately 141 miles an hour. One of the big action sequences involves a battle between two vast armies, which stretch as far as computer-generated effects can see. One army is human. The other army is made of countless creatures named Anubis that look like giant savage dogs that stand upright and run on their hind legs. It is not done well, but one is surprised to find it done at all. These armies clash in bloody swordplay. Each dog creature, as it is killed, reverts to the desert sand from whence it sprang. Finally, all the creatures are destroyed, and we see the victors standing around feeling victorious and wishing that high fives had been invented. And we notice that not one single member of the victorious army is dead or even wounded. Pathetic that thousands of years of ancient curses and spells could engender such an incompetent army of dog sand creatures. Several readers have argued with the rule in Ebert's little movie glossary that teaches us, no good movie has ever featured a hot air balloon. To be sure, there are exceptions, but The Mummy Returns is not one of them. Its hot air balloon looks like the ship that sailed to the land of Winken, Blinken and Nod. At one point, the action returns to London, and we see Tower Bridge, the Dome of St. Paul's, and Big Ben clustered closely together in one shot. This is no doubt to make it easy for the geographically challenged. Perhaps adding a few snapshots from Madonna's wedding would not have been too much. The 1999 remake of The Mummy is personally one of my all-time favorite adventure entertainment movies ever made. But I'm not reviewing that film today. For this post, I'll be reviewing its 2001 sequel titled The Mummy Returns. Now, it's no surprise that when Hollywood releases a hit summer blockbuster, there's bound to be a sequel, and in most cases the sequel has to be bigger and more epic. In this regard, The Mummy Returns definitely succeeds as a larger and more action-packed adventure film. However, being a bigger film obviously doesn't mean better. There was a time in which I hated this sequel and found it completely inferior to its predecessor. But over the years, it's actually grown on me. Nowadays, I look at The Mummy Returns as on par with, say, Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, which was the weakest of the original Indiana Jones films, but undeniably a fun adventure film that's worth repeated viewings. While I still have some issues with The Mummy Returns, it's still a perfectly satisfying adventure sequel. Our story begins with the origin of a sinister warrior only referred to as the Scorpion King. Back in ancient times, this evil soldier made a deal with the dark Egyptian god Anubis to take command of an immortal army that he would lead to conquer his enemies. After granting his wish, the god Anubis put both the Scorpion King and his army into a deep sleep at the base of a pyramid, hidden in the middle of a mystical oasis. All that remains is a golden bracelet which can lead anyone to the pyramid, where any worthy champion can challenge the Scorpion King in battle for the chance to take command of his immortal army. Back in the present, it's been 9 years since Rick and Evelyn Evie O'Connell defeated the mummy Imhotep in the previous film. While they've had a healthy relationship and raised a son, Evie is receiving mysterious visions. They lead our heroes to a temple, where they discover the golden bracelet of the Scorpion King. The bracelet soon latches itself onto their son Alex, making him a living guide to the hidden oasis. Meanwhile, the O'Connell's greatest foe Imhotep has been unearthed and revived by an evil sorceress named Mila, who is also the modern-day reincarnation of the mummy's ancient love Ankh-Su-Namun. With these two evil lovers reunited, they kidnap Alex and use him as their guide, as they aim to kill the Scorpion kind and command his army. So the chase is on for our heroes to rescue their son, learn the secrets of the ancient past, and prevent this clash between two immortal titans. All the cast members from the previous film are back, some with improvements, while others have fallen by the wayside. Rachel Weisz still gives a strong leading performance in the role of Evie. On the flip side, Brendan Fraser is looking tired and is far less charming in the role of Rick O'Connell than he was in the previous film. The comedic side character Jonathan is starting to get grating, and even more pointless than before. The Magi warrior Ardeth Bay is back from the first film, and he's just as awesome as ever, and really shines in some cool action scenes. The son Alex is your typical child character, nothing bad, but nothing special either. One thing that I have mixed feels about is how the characters are given deeper backstories. Rick, for example, has become some sort of prophesized hero that can slay the Scorpion King. Evie is revealed to be the reincarnation of an Egyptian princess named Nefertiti, who was the daughter of the very same pharaoh that was murdered by Imhotep during the flashback of the first movie. On the one hand, it takes quiet the suspension of disbelief that all these people came together like this. Yet, at the same time, all this added backstory does make the characters and their relation with the villains a lot more interesting. On that note, the film boasts quite the entertaining collection of different villains. Both old and new Arnold Vosloo reprises his signature role as the mummy Imhotep, and his performance is just as good as before. The only downside is that he spends a lot of time in his human form, and we don't get to see a cool evolutionary progression of his decayed body like we did in the previous movie. The evil sorceress Mila is another excellent villain, and played very well by Patricia Velasquez, who again is reprising her role from the first film. She steals the show with every scene she's in, and her character is even more heartless than the mummy himself, which makes her a lot more fun to hate. There's also a really cool evil henchman named Loc Naw, who's one of those menacing supporting villains that stands out with his own unique cool factor. The only villain I didn't care for is this one museum curator who leads a clan of bad guys with red hoods. This guy just felt like unnecessary added fluff, as we already had the mummy, the scorpion kind, the evil sorceries, and the nasty henchmen. Seriously, what did we need this guy for? Next, let's cover all the other positive aspects of the film before I address the negatives. Looking back, I had honestly forgotten how much fun the action sequences are in this film, how busy they are, and how they come in a nice variety too. There's more gunplay, hand-to-hand combat, and lots of really cool sword fights. There's a scene in which our heroes are attacked by the skeleton warriors from the first film, which leads into a deeply thrilling chase on a double-decker bus. Also, there's not just one, but two catfights between our female leads, which both feature great fighting choreography, and two good-looking women fighting each other while dressed in skimpy, tight-body hugging outfits. This was one of the main selling images on the poster, and for obvious reasons. I also like that there's more traveling in this film, and lots of imaginative locations. This helps make the film feel more like an adventure, and it further expands on the mythos and lore of the mummy universe. I already loved the Egypt setting of the first film, but this movie goes even further with an expanded mythology and more ground to cover. The new instrumental music track was composed by Alan Silvestri, who's a very talented composer, and gives this film a worthy soundtrack that heightens the action and adventure elements of the film. There's also an original song titled "Forever May Not Be Long Enough," performed by Live, and it's actually a really cool song. The theme is admittedly out of context with the film, but it's still great to listen to, and somehow works along with a film in an Egyptian setting. Now it's time to cover the things that annoy me in this sequel. The first thing to note is that when compared to its predecessor, this film doesn't have much horror-related material. Granted, the first film was obviously an action-adventure film, but it also kept one foot firmly rooted in the horror genre. It had an occasionally eerie atmosphere and some creepy elements. Considering that our star villain is the mummy, it just feels more appropriate to have some kind balance between adventure and horror. The Mummy Returns is 100% adventure action, with some predictable second-rate jump scares thrown in. The closest the film ever gets to feeling like a horror film is this one scene where the decayed version of the mummy kills three people on a train to regain its human flesh. But even that is very mild. A lot of the CGI, while impressive for the time, has become very dated, with noticeable green screen effects and cartoony monsters. We do at least get a nice variety of new creatures, including an army of dingo-faced soldiers and nasty midget mummies. Like many sequels, this film has a really bad habit of recreating scenes and making direct references to the first film. Remember that scene when the mummy created a giant sandstorm that formed his face? Well, he's doing it again with water. Remember that funny joke with the objects falling over in a domino effect? Well, this film does it again. Lather, rinse, and repeat. I'd call it a nitpick, but the film is constantly recreating memorable scenes from its predecessor, as if it's scared to have an identity of its own. The self-referential Hummer is also really tired in this film. Actually, a lot of the comedy is borderline silly. This especially applies to Brendan Fraser, whose deadpan delivery gets very annoying. Also, the first film had this humble old-school look and feel, whereas this film feels more polished and modern, with slow motion and way too much wire work during the action. One minor announce that always gets to me in other films is when a main character dies and is then brought back at the end. Yes, there's a scene in this film when one of my favorite characters actually dies, and while I'm happy to see said character come back, it also defeats the drama and just feels pointless. The adventure comes to a close with an epic climax, which harkens back to the style of a Star Wars finale, as we watch multiple action sequences at once. Rick battles Imhotep in an exciting final battle, Evie gets into another sword fight with Mila, and Ardeth leads his Magi army into battle against the army of Anubis. It all keeps building to the long-awaited resurrection of the monstrous Scorpion King. His design is outstanding, as he's a giant scorpion-slash-human hybrid, but unfortunately the CGI effects that bring him to life are some of the worst I've ever seen. It's still a really cool final battle, and there's one standout moment that's almost Oscar-worthy. Said moment being when both Rick and Imhotep are about to be dragged into hell, and each yells out a different plea to the woman they love, only for both women to do the complete opposite of what they were told. This scene was beautifully shot, very well acted, and leads to the most touching bit of human emotion as conveyed by our main villain just before he dies. Shortly after The Mummy Returns came a spin-off movie titled The Scorpion King, which was also silly, but a harmlessly derivative adventure film. I definitely have more to say about that film, but I'll save it for my next review. Then there was The Mummy, the animated series, which ran for 2 seasons on Kids WB. This series continued the adventures of the O'Connell family and featured a whole gallery of new villains and mystical creatures for them to encounter. I remember watching it and liking it okay, but it really wasn't that memorable either. Then in 2008 came a third film titled The Mummy, Tomb of the Dragon Emperor, and this one was really bad. In an effort to further expand on the mummy universe, this film flew way too close to the sun and became an unorganized, boring mess. Its one saving grace was an awesome final battle climax, with armies of mummies battling hordes of zombies. It's pretty sweet. Unfortunately, the characters are worse than ever, and there isn't even an ounce of spooky material. Every single problem I had with The Mummy Returns is multiplied by 20. And leaving us fans with a hollow and empty shell of a sequel that doesn't even feel like it's from the same franchise. The Mummy Returns is often described as a lesser sequel, but when compared to everything else that came after, it really isn't that bad. In fact, I'd go so far as to say that The Mummy Returns works just fine as an entertaining and mostly complete sequel. It develops the characters further, explores the universe more, and features some of the franchise's best action sequences. While it's still dated and brought down by some noticeable problems, it's by no means terrible. If fun Saturday afternoon fodder is all you want, then this sequel delivers the goods and is a mostly entertaining experience. Other information about this film. The Mummy Returns in a very big way. considerably more elaborate and spectacular in its special effects than was the film that brought Universal's musty corpse back to life 2 years ago. This follow-up still lacks the wit and elan that would have made this burgeoning series more than a popcorn picture franchise. But the widescreen here virtually bursts with visual goodies, and writer-director Stephen Sommers scarcely allows the actors, or the audience, a moment to take a breath during the non-stop action of the final hour. The original unearthed more than $414 million worldwide, and there is no reason this one shouldn't follow suit. With all the key personnel intact from the initial installment, the new film similarly operates most successfully on a 12-year-old, comic book appeal level. Once again, the dialogue is hokey. Every crisis is too easily dealt with, and the whole enterprise lacks the flair and sophistication that made Raiders of the Lost Ark just as appealing to adults as it was to kids. Perhaps unequipped to eradicate these problems, Sommers has fixed on the alternative solution of minimizing them, essentially by filling the screen with so many dazzling sights and distracting incidents that one's grown-up self is eventually persuaded to step aside to allow the little kid inside if it's not too mummified to have a good time. Sommers and company must have felt liberated by the success of the first venture, for the visions of mythical antiquity they bring to often ridiculous but undeniably eye-catching life are vastly grander this time around. The hidden door secret passageway magic bracelet don't open this box, if you know what's good for you trappings are straight out of B-movies. But the sheer spectacle of swarms of scorpions rising from the sand, mummy warriors marauding through the streets of London, a homemade dirigible puttering through deep ravines on its way to a gleaming golden pyramid in a hidden jungle, and an army, as big as the desert, of ancient warrior hounds descending over the dunes, all accomplished with extraordinary visual credibility, puts the film toward the high end of visual effects-driven experiences. The plot, of course, is just a pretext to get the mummy and his minions alive and jumping again. It's 1933, 8 years after the action of the last picture. In the interim, Yank adventurer Rick O'Connell, Brendan Fraser, and Egyptologist Evelyn Rachel Weisz have married and produced a kid, Alex Freddy Both, who's to the manor born in that, on his first foray into a shadowy Egyptian tomb, he emerges with a golden bracelet that everybody wants. Once again, Rick and Evelyn must contend with the resurrected 3-year-old mummy Imhotep Arnold Vosloo, who emerges from his slumber in crusty condition only to once again assume superhuman strength. Reunited with his long-ago love, Ankh-Su Naman, reincarnated as Mila Patricia Velasquez, Imhotep is determined to at last rule the world through control of the enormous army of the Scorpion King World Wrestling Federation star The Rock, a fearsome warrior who has been waiting in limbo for 5,000 years to claim the total victory for which he sold his soul to Anubis. If the Scorpion King is allowed to reawaken, Imhotep will have quite a fight on his hands. After this backstory is laid out by way of a furious but conspicuously bloodless battle in ancient Thebes, Rick, Evelyn, and Alex are pursued to their London mansion by Imhotep's earthly cronies, an exotic band led by Mila and Lok Na Edwale Akinoy Agbage, a turbaned sword twirler single-mindedly devoted to detaching Alex from the coveted gold bracelet. Unless they prevent it, the baddies warn, the Scorpion King will arise from the dead in 7 days, starting a chain reaction that could start the next apocalypse. After a lot of boisterousness involving some flashy hand-to-hand combat, Evelyn's ritual near sacrifice in the bowels of the British Museum, a wild nocturnal chase on a double-decker bus, and Alex's kidnapping, the action returns to Egypt, where the Scorpion King's imminent return has everybody in a dither. From this point on, the plot is yanked this way and that in order to create virtually no downtime in the dizzying succession of action and fight scenes, whose number would have more than filled an entire 15-episode Republic serial. Rick Evelyn, the latter's brother Jonathan John Hannah, back for more comic relief, in the broadest sense of the term, and the mysterious Ardith Bey Oded Fayer, also returning, wise in the ways of the desert and its lore, hire a boat-like dirigible that carries them over the desert in search of Alex and his abductors. in the course of the race to the legendary Golden Pyramid, which, of course, no man has ever seen and lived to tell of it. Imhotep sends a wall of water roaring through a gorge to engulf the dirigible. Nasty pygmy mummies chase everyone through the underbrush of the forest surrounding the pyramid. Evelyn and Mila, in their ancient and reincarnated personas, get to enact not one but two beautifully choreographed dagger fights. Evelyn is killed well, maybe. Rick must battle both Imhotep and the Scorpion King. And, best of all, from a spectacle POV, Ardith Bay's dramatically black-garbed soldiers face off in the desert against the terrifying canine army of Anubis. Fans of The Rock probably will get more laughs than thrills out of the wrestler's feature film debut, in which his head and torso have been grafted onto a giant scorpion's body. A pretty silly sight, to be sure. But at least he doesn't have to deliver any dialogue, which is not Sommers' strong suit. Fraser, looking slightly bulkier than he did in the original, remains ideally suited for this sort of lighthearted fun, although his character feels sidelined more than before in favor of the attention given to the even more numerous supporting players. Of the latter, Vosloo, Velasquez, Akinoy Agbage, and Fair take the most advantage of the opportunities, their dashing looks cutting striking figures against the exotic comic book backdrops. Pick's strongest suit is its visual splendor, achieved through a virtually seamless melding of impressive sets, great locations in Morocco, Egypt, and Jordan, colorful costumes, and first-rate CGI work by Industrial Light and Magic and visual effects supervised by John Burton. Alan Silvestri's energetic score reps an improvement on Jerry Goldsmith's laborious musical support for the first installment. The 1999 remake of the horror classic, The Mummy, surprised Universal Pictures with its box office success. The studio had expected it to be profitable, but not that profitable. However, long before the worldwide gross crept close to $400 million, Universal had already put two additional Mummy films into the hopper, awarding the series the franchise label. The Mummy Returns, which reunites nearly the entire cast from the 1999 movie, is the first of these two productions. The other, a prequel called The Scorpion King, will be released either later this year or next year, depending on how Universal arranges its release schedule. Stephen Sommers' 1999 feature was an enjoyable, if overlong, romp recounting the struggles of an adventurer and his companions to stop the apocalyptic agenda of an ancient Egyptian priest. While not entirely successful, The Mummy nevertheless boasted an infectious blend of high adventure, low-scare horror, and special effects that transformed it into a crowd-pleaser capable of sating the early summer audience until The Phantom Menace came along a few weeks later. Now, Rick O'Connell, Brendan Fraser, Evie O'Connell, Rachel Weisz, Jonathan Carnahan, John Hannah, Ardith Bay, Odid Fair, and of course Imhotep Arnold Vosloo are all back. Joining them are a couple of notable newcomers, Rick and Evie's son, Alex Freddy both, and the dreaded Scorpion King WWF mainstay, The Rock. The story for The Mummy Returns is a meager and muddled affair peppered with Deus Ex Machina contrivances. A cult of power-mad Egyptologists, is there another kind, have concocted a plan by which they can obtain world domination. First, they must resurrect Imhotep, the mummy from the first film, since they are being led by the ancient priest's reincarnated girlfriend, Ankh-Su-Namun Patricia Velazquez. This proves to be surprisingly easy. Then, with his powers restored, Imhotep heads off to do battle with the mythical Scorpion King, whose tomb lies in a pyramid at the center of a hidden oasis. In order to find that oasis, Imhotep needs an artifact which happens to be in the possession of Alex O'Connell. And, when the boy is kidnapped, that brings his parents, his uncle Jonathan, and their old friend, Ardith Bay, into the conflict. This results in a lot of chasing around the globe and a climax that features a special effects-laden battle between a large force of humans and an army of decaying, dog-faced creatures. The fundamental problem underlying The Mummy Returns is the reason that the movie exists in the first place. This is not the byproduct of the creative process. It's an offshoot of Universal Pictures' greed. The sequel was made not because the filmmakers had a compelling story to tell, but because The Mummy made so much money that a second installment became mandatory. This thought process results in countless pointless and derivative sequels, a class in which The Mummy Returns unquestionably belongs. The plot is just a flimsy excuse to bring back old friends and stick them in a series of cliffhangers. It's low-rent Raiders of the Lost Ark, with high-quality special effects filling in for character development and intelligible storytelling. Some of the action sequences in The Mummy Returns are fun, and the visual effects are more polished and less noticeably fake than in the previous film. Unfortunately, all of this can't obscure the fact that there is basically no plot. The clash of armies at the end has no purpose beyond showing off the effects maven's skills at the computer. In terms of style, it's reminiscent of the war in The Phantom Menace, albeit without the same strong story motivation. The Mummy Returns has opportunities to do interesting things at one point. There's a chance to force Imhotep and Rick into an uneasy alliance, but that is neatly bypassed. Like the Indiana Jones movies, The Mummy Returns tries to blend low-key humor with a non-stop series of cliffhangers. However, while some of the jokes are funny, the action sequences are only sporadically satisfying, owing primarily to their often preposterous resolutions. And, while Rick possesses a certain charm, he's no Indiana Jones. Brendan Fraser and Rachel Weisz rekindle the cute chemistry that existed between their characters in The Mummy. Freddie Boeuf makes an effective addition to the cast, primarily because he's not as annoying as most movie kids. John Hannah is back as the fatuous Jonathan. Arnold Vosloo's Imhotep is subtly diminished, perhaps because he now has to share the spotlight with two other villains. Patricia Velasquez has an expanded role here from the one she essayed in the first film, and the part of the Scorpion King doesn't challenge the Rock's thespian abilities. All he has to do is snarl and look tough things he is familiar with from his day job. The Mummy Returns offers one surprise and unexpectedly poignant dramatic moment in which we feel a surge of sympathy for one of the characters. Unfortunately, it's for one of the bad guys, which makes the ending a downer. Overall, the film probably offers what fans of The Mummy are expecting. The thinner, unnecessarily long storyline notwithstanding, this is essentially more of the same. It's hollow, lightweight entertainment, not unpleasant, but far from the Sommers' definitive action-adventure flick. More details. 7 years after defeating the Mummy Imhotep Arnold Vosloo, Rick Brendan Fraser and Evelyn O'Connell Rachel Weisz are dragged back into the action when forces working to resurrect Imhotep kidnap their 6-year-old son and take him to Egypt. Hot in pursuit, Rick and Evelyn race to prevent Imhotep and his servants from reviving the dreaded Scorpion King Dwayne Johnson and seizing control of the army of Anubis. The Mummy Returns is a lot of things. Ostensibly, it is a 2001 sequel to the surprise 1999 hit The Mummy. It is also a textbook example of how to cripple a nascent movie franchise, a showcase of overambitious and woefully mishandled visual effects, an egregious abuse of popular Egyptian mythology, and more than anything else, a stern lesson for Hollywood that rushing a film to meet a predetermined release date will never end well. Many of the ingredients that made the 1999 film a delight are retained. Brendan Fraser still plays his entertaining matinee idol role with warmth and humor. Odid Fayer still infuses the Magi swordsman Ardeth Bey with gravitas and dignity, and a neat underlying lightness. Arnold Vosloo still gives the villainous Imhotep a strong, muscular edge. The orchestral score Alan Silvestri replaces Jerry Goldsmith continues to emphasize a classically old-fashioned atmosphere of stirring adventure. Beyond this, the film really is all over the place. The plot manages to be both overly complicated and weirdly arbitrary. It begins by introducing a new villain, the Scorpion King, in ancient Egypt. He tries to invade and fails miserably. And at the point of death, while exiled to the desert, he makes a bargain with Anubis to gain supernatural powers and control over a magical army of ferocious dog people. A quick note to the writers, the evil god they were looked for was Set, not Anubis, and even then he was a god of chaos rather than evil. Once the Scorpion King succeeds in his invasion, his soul is taken by Anubis and the dog army dissolves to sand. That's the problem with deals with gods, I suppose. There's always the pesky fine print. It should be noted that The Mummy Returns was Dwayne Johnson's first significant dramatic role, following guest appearances on the TV shows The Net and Star Trek Voyager, and his lack of experience at this early career stage is painfully clear. Cut to 1933, and the O'Connells are now married with a son named Alex Freddy Both. Both was 9 when he shot The Mummy Returns, but his character can only be 6 given the timeline between first film and sequel. In the actor's defense, he's a far less risible than the typical kid sidekick in these sorts of films. That said, the character is still a painful irritant on the rest of the film. A more cleanly structured sequel might have allocated his story role. He gets irreparably attached to a bracelet that leads to the Scorpion King's lair to his mother Evelyn, which would have both removed the annoying child stereotype and given Rachel Weisz more material with which to work. The O'Connells find the bracelet. Alex gets it attached to his wrist. Imhotep is raised by the reincarnation of his long-dead lover Ankh Su Namun Patricia Velasquez. Rick is revealed as a prophesied warrior of Egyptian legend. Evelyn is revealed as the reincarnation of the princess Nefertiti. Everyone races to the fabled oasis of Om Shir, and Rick and Imhotep battle one another in a pyramid to defeat the revived Scorpion King and either control or dispel the army of Anubis. It is a narrative mess, and shows a remarkably rushed and inattentive scripting process. If the script feels rushed, it has nothing on the film's visual effects. The Mummy Returns is an enormously ambitious film, with a CGI list of requirements that includes undead warriors, forests sprouting from deserts, zombie pygmies, thousands of dog warriors, and a climactic half-man, half-scorpion monster. There is not a single visual effect in the film that does not look substandard and rushed. The Scorpion King in particular is an embarrassment to the whole film. Industrial Light and Magic famously begged Universal Pictures to delay the film's release by 6 months so that they could do a proper job. But a fixed release date was considered more important than a decent film. It all but kills the film. One could possibly overcome the weak writing and flabby narrative if there were some dramatic and visually engaging action sequences and chases, but it all collapses to pieces. It is an enormous shame. The 1999 Mummy presented a wonderfully entertaining blend of adventure, comedy, and horror, and could easily have been the foundation of a sustained and commercially successful franchise. Instead, The Mummy got killed stone dead with its second installment. It was another 7 years before Universal returned with a modified cast and a new director to make The Mummy, Tomb of the Dragon Emperor. After that, the studio cut its losses and aimed for a complete reboot. Is The Mummy Returns the worst sequel imaginable? Of course not, but if you asked if it was one of the most disappointing, that leads to a different answer. The Mummy, the 1999 remake of the 1932 horror film, proved to be a major success for filmmakers Stephen Sommers and Universal Studios. 2 years later, both the director and the studio reunited its major stars for a sequel set a decade later. In doing so, Sommers and Universal created a 4-movie franchise. Like the first film, The Mummy Returns began thousands of years ago, in ancient Egypt. However, this flashback focused on an Egyptian mercenary named Matthias, who makes an unsuccessful attempt to conquer the land. He and his army is exiled to the desert of Om Shir, where most of them die from heat exhaustion, except for Matthias. The latter offers his soul to the god Anubis for the power to defeat his enemies. The latter creates an oasis called Om Shir to hide the newly dubbed Scorpion King's pyramid and gives the latter a legion of humanoid jackal warriors to seek revenge. The army of Anubis sweeps across Egypt, destroying everything in its path. But once their task is finished, Anubis claims the Scorpion King's soul and his army. The movie jumps to the year 1933, which finds the O'Connell family Rick, Evelyn Evie, and their son Alex exploring the ruins of Thebes. Evie and Rick discover the bracelet of Anubis, unaware that Alex has stumbled across a trio of mercenaries attempting to take the bracelet for themselves. The family returns home to England, and unbeknownst to his parents, Alex tries on the bracelet and experiences a vision with directions to the oasis of Om Shir. Unfortunately, a group of Egyptian cultists, who had hired the three thugs, invades the O'Connell estate and kidnaps Evie. The O'Connell's old comrade, the Magi warrior Ardith Bey, arrives to help, but is unable to prevent Evie's kidnapping. The cultists take her to the British Museum, where they resurrect the body of Egyptian high priest and sorcerer Imhotep. They plan to use his power to defeat the sorcerer king. Rick, his brother-in-law Jonathan Carnahan, Alex and Ardith arrive at the museum to rescue Evie. After the O'Connells, Jonathan and Ardith manage to escape the army of mummified soldiers. Alex, who is still wearing the Anubis bracelet, is kidnapped by the cultists. The four adults track him to Egypt, where they recruit the help of Rick's old World War I friend, Izzy Buttons, to rescue Alex from Imhotep and the cultists and prevent them from reviving the army of Anubis. I usually dislike horror films, but I noticed that the 1999 movie, The Mummy, seemed more like an adventure film in the style of the Indiana Jones movie franchise. I could say the same about The Mummy Returns. And considering my dislike of horror films, I say, thank God. However, the movie has enough elements to satisfy those who love this particular genre. This was especially apparent in the scenes that featured Imhotep's murder of the three mercenaries, the O'Connell's battle against the High Priest's mummified soldiers during the bus ride through London, and during the finale sequence inside the Scorpion King's pyramid at Alm Shir. The sight of the Scorpion King as a transformed centaurid or scorpion monster was enough to give me the heebie-jeebies. But if I had to select the one sequence that truly captured aspects of the horror genre, it was the one that featured the O'Connell's attack upon the cultists in the Alm Shir jungle that I found particularly off-putting. Not only did the movie's heroes have to attack the cultists in order to save Alex, both sides of the conflict had to deal the pygmy mummies that attacked and killed anyone or any army that marched through the jungle. What can I say? Those pygmies really freaked me out. The Mummy Returns did feature a good deal of action sequences that seemed more like an adventure than a horror story, thank goodness. The O'Connells' escape from the flooding of the Thebes Pyramid, their escape from Imhotep's attempt to drown them with a tsunami wave, their escape from the destruction of the Alm Shir Pyramid and various hand-to-hand fight sequences thankfully reminded me that The Mummy Returns was more of an adventure story. Also, Stephen Sommers provided a great deal of rich characterization and humor in his screenwriter. Like the 1999 film, The Mummy Returns featured some sophomoric humor. But if I must be honest, a good deal of the humor seemed sharper and wittier this particular film, especially in the hands of one particular character, Izzy Buttons. In fact, my favorite line in the film came him. "Whatever it is, whatever you need, I don't care. Forget it, O'Connell. Every time I hook up with you, I get shot. Last time, I got shot in the ass. I'm in mourning for my ass." I never mentioned this in my review of The Mummy, but I was also impressed by Sommers' handling of the sequence featuring Imhotep's background and introduction at the beginning of the film. The opening sequence featuring the Scorpion King's introduction struck me as mediocre. But I was very impressed by the flashback sequence about Evelyn's past life in the form of the Princess Nefertiti and her witness of her father, Pharaoh Seti I. Sommers has a real talent for costumed melodrama, and it would be nice to see him exploit it in the fullest in his career. This sequence also featured a first-rate fight scene between Rachel Weisz's Nefertiti and Patricia Velasquez's Ankh Su-Namun. Of course, one cannot talk about The Mummy Returns without bringing up its visual effects. First of all, kudos to cinematographer Adrian Biddle for continuing the beautiful photography for which he was responsible in the first film. I especially enjoyed his work in the sequence that featured the parallel journeys across Egypt by both the O'Connell and Imhotep parties. Alan Cameron and his crew did an excellent job in recreating not only England and Egypt of the early 1930s, but also ancient Egypt. The team of Ahmed Abounaum, Giles Masters and Tony Reading added a great deal to Cameron's work with their beautiful and colorful art designs. I have always enjoyed Alan Silvestri's music in past movies, but I must admit that I really appreciated his use of Middle Eastern or North African style in the movie's score. I do admire the special effects created by the movie's visual effects team. I was especially impressed by their work in the Om Sheer Jungle sequence. However, there were times I found it a bit over the top. I noticed that Sommers hired his costume designer from the last film, John Bloomfield, to design the costumes for this film. And I wish to God he had hired someone else. I had no problem with Bloomfield's costumes for the ancient Egypt sequences. His costume designs for the 1933 scenes, namely the costumes for the female characters, were another matter. Honestly, they sucked. I was far from impressed by Bloomfield's recreation of 1920s fashion for Evelyn's character in the 1999 movie. His recreation of early 1930s fashions for the female characters were just as bad as shown in the images below. I can only shake my head in disbelief. The above were Bloomfield's idea of 1932-33 women's fashion. Really, they looked more like a modern-day take on the fashions of that particular era. The fact that both Weisz and Velasquez are sporting modern hairstyles does not help. At least I cannot complain about the acting. An episode of Star Trek Voyager featured the first project in which Dwayne Johnson portrayed a character other than himself. He had nothing to do but engage in a fight scene. The Mummy Returns featured his second role in which he portrayed another character. Again, he had no lines. At least Sommers managed to effectively direct him into expressing his character via body language. The other cast members, on the other hand, had speaking lines. The movie featured solid performances from the likes of Bruce Byron, Joe Dixon, and Tom Fisher as the three thugs hired by the cultists to assist them. Alun Armstrong gave a surprisingly effective performance as Mr. Hafez, the leader of the Egyptian cultists. Unlike most Western actors, Armstrong managed to portray a non-Western villain without resorting to theatrical acting. My favorite performance came from Sean Parks, who was both hysterically witty as O'Connell's old friend, Izzy Buttons. I usually have mixed feelings about child actors, but I must admit that I enjoyed Freddie Both's engaging performance as Rick and Evelyn's boisterous son, Alex. The Mummy Returns was the first movie or television production I had noticed Edwale Akinoye Agbaje, and his performance as Mr. Hafez's chief enforcer, Lok Na, was, well, magnificent. In fact, I could say the same about his screen presence. Patricia Velasquez may not have been the world's greatest actress, and there were times I found her verbal performance as Femme Fatale Mila Nyes and ancient Egyptian courtesan Ankh Su Namun a bit limited. She more than made up this flaw with a strong ability for silent acting and a very impressive screen presence. Again, she proved to have a great screen chemistry with Arnold Vasslou, who returned as the Egyptian high priest, Imhotep. What can I say about Vasslou's performance? The man is Imhotep both in presence and performance. He did a marvelous job in conveying both the frightening aspects of his character and the latter's passionate love for Ankh Su Namun. Happily, Odid Fayer reprised his role as Medjay warrior Ardeth Bey. And not only was he great, as always. For the first time, I became aware of Fayer's talent for comedic acting. John Hannah was as funny as ever as Evelyn's ne'er-do-well older brother, Jonathan Carnahan. I found him especially funny in his scenes with Both and Parks. Rachel Weisz reprised her role as Evelyn Evie Carnahan O'Connell, and I was surprised by the level of development in her character. Weisz did an excellent job in conveying the mature development of Evie and maintaining the character's familiar quirks at the same. Weisz was also excellent as the Princess Nefertiti, who was not only fervently protective of her father, but also suspicious of Ankh Su Namun. The character of Rick O'Connell also struck me as surprisingly different in this movie. Like Evelyn, marriage and parenthood had developed him into a more mature personality. And like Evelyn, he also maintained some of his personality quirks. And Brendan Fraser did an excellent job in conveying both the familiar and different aspects of Rick's character. The Mummy Returns effectively continued the exciting adventure and horror of the 1999 film, thanks to Stephen Sommers' writing and direction. And I enjoyed it very much, along with the entertaining performances of the cast led by Brendan Fraser and Rachel Weisz. But as much as I continue to enjoy it, there is a part of me that wished Sommers had not been so over the top with some of his direction and the special effects featured in the movie. It seemed as if he was trying to outdo his work in the first film. And sometimes, that is not a good thing. This film directed by Steven Sommers. Written by Steven Sommers. Produced by Sean Daniel. James Jax. Starring Brendan Fraser, Rachel Weisz, John Hannah, Arnold Vosloo, Oded Fehr, Patricia Velasquez, Dwayne Johnson. Cinematography, Adrian Biddle. Edited by Bob Duxay, Kelly Matsumoto. Music by Alan Silvestri. Production companies, Universal Pictures, Alphaville Films. Distributed by Universal Pictures. Release date, May 4th, 2001. Running time, 129 minutes. Country, United States. Languages, English, Arabic. Budget, $98 million. Box office, $435 million. So guys, this is the review of the Mummy Returns movie and some information about it. How do you like our today's video? Please let us know by commenting, and if you like this video, please like.